What you just saw is a Dung's argumentation framework. Nodes and arrows. Nothing else, nothing more. And this is, well, in the literature since quite a seminal paper. It's probably one of the most cited paper in Artificial Intelligence Journal. Definitely is the most cited paper in argumentation community. And this is probably very few formulae in the slides. This is one of them. But it's pretty important, but at the same time, it's pretty easy. So you have that a Dung's argumentation framework formally is a set of arguments and a relation. Well, the relation is a binary relation on the set of arguments. So you go from one argument to another argument. You take an argument attacks another argument. That's it. Now, you have the syntax, what you can do out of it. The syntax is just arguments and attacks. Very simple. But as Gerard mentioned before, the real power behind the Dung's argumentation framework is to come out with acceptable set of arguments, where the idea of acceptability means that generally they can survive the attacks together and they can satisfy some principles behind. Now, Dung's prepared set of definitions for semantics, and Gerhard went through those definitions before. We will go through now again, very briefly, hopefully. But works after Dung, we're also looking at what are the actual principles behind those definitions. So what can be described in human understandable terms, what is just described in formula. And those were work of Pietro Baroni, Massimiliano Giacomin, and further on also with Martin Caminada in two very important papers. Now, there are plenty of properties that they described. We will just go through those that are necessary to describe the semantics that Dung proposed in 1995, that are the semantics you already saw before with Gerhard. One of them is conflict freeness. So you want that your extension, your set of arguments that are collectively acceptable should be free from conflicts. Another one is admissibility, which means that the extension should be able to stand alone against the other attacks. So altogether, a set of arguments should defend the set itself. Strong admissibility says that you should ground your defense on an attacked argument. So if you just have a cycle, A attacking B and B attacking A, then no argument is unattacked, so that no extension there will ever satisfy this strong admissibility. Reinstatement says that if you defend an argument, then you should take this argument on board. You should be generous. You should take him with you in your extension. And then finally, I-maximality says that no extension should be a subset of another. And the last one is that directionality means that a set of argument is affected only by the attackers, so by the arguments that are before them in the graph. So we started from here. This is an example of Dung's argumentation framework. Let me put some labels here and there just to compact the graph a little more. So this is the same exact graph as we saw before, right? Just with symbols. Now, what you can have with admissibility and restatement? Well, you can have a set of conflict-free arguments such that each defended argument is included in the extension. These gives you the complete extensions. So in this case, you have that A, C, E, and G are always a possible complete extension. And then you can have also either B or D. And that's giving you the other two complete extensions. And each of these sets is a complete extension. It satisfies admissibility and reinstatement. Now, if we go to the ground extension satisfies the strong admissibility. So something to be inside the extension must be grounded, it defends, in an attacked argument. So what are the unattacked arguments here? ACEG. Right? And are there other arguments that can be, are those arguments defending any other argument in the graph? Like? B. So B, J is defending B against H, right? But is G defending B against all the possible attacks? So there is at least one attack towards B that is not defended by something that is unattacked itself. So those four arguments are not enough to defend B directly, right? And this is the reason why the only and the unique grounded extension is A, C, E, and G. Because all the other arguments there, you can choose one, but it will defend against itself against the other. So B can be in a complete extension, as we saw before, but because B defends against D, it defends itself against D. So B doesn't need external support for defending itself against the attack from D, because B is attacking D against, but is not strongly admissible because the defense is not grounded in an attacked argument. That's why B cannot be in the grounded extension. Now, if you have admissibility and maximality, it means that you have the maximal, with respect to set inclusion, complete extensions. And this is giving you the preferred extensions. So, if you take the complete extension we saw before, and you take the maximum with respect to set inclusion, those are the preferred extensions. And finally, the stable extension is complete extensions that attack all the arguments outside. So basically, there are no arguments that are unattacked. And in this case, the stable extensions correspond to the preferred extensions. Yeah, that is pretty much possible.